Hello, and welcome to the second part of this seven-part series on Windows Server 2012 R2, the Essentials Experience, where we'll be talking about the features and functionality that were previously only available in the Essentials Edition, but are now available as a role in the Standard and Data Center Editions as well. So in this presentation, we'll be talking about the different deployment options that you have and also take a look at some of the licensing implications and some of the licensing information that you should know about. So as we get started here, a quick look at our agenda. Again, we'll be talking about the deployment options you have for both the Essentials Edition as well as when you're using the new Windows Server Essentials Experience role in the Standard or Data Center Editions as well. And then we'll spend some time talking about licensing, and I wanted to go over these various aspects so you can see how they work together and how they relate again to either the edition or the role running in the Standard and Data Center Editions as well. So just to try to clear up any confusion that may be out there. So let's get started with the deployment options. And this really encompasses a couple of the major new features that are available in Windows Server 2012 R2. So the first of which is that with the Essentials Edition, we now have the ability to use the Essentials Edition license to run the server instance as a virtual machine and use that exact same license to be the Hyper-V host. So you can do both run the parent partition as well as the guest partition using one single license of Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials. So we'll take a look at how that plays out. The other thing that, of course, is new is that we now have a Windows Server Essential Experience role. And so this gives us some new flexibility in how the server can be deployed in environments with more than 25 users. So we'll also take a closer look at that. So really what this gives you then is three different deployment options that we would typically see. The first is the one that we have had for a long time, which is that you would use the Windows Server Essentials Edition and you would just deploy it on a physical server. And very often we'll see our OEM partners offering their server hardware with the Essentials Edition pre-installed on that. It's a great first server for smaller businesses and a very typical deployment. And what's new is now you can also use the Windows Server Essentials Edition for a virtual deployment so that you can run Hyper-V on your server and then run Essentials as a guest operating system. And then finally, because we have the new Windows Server Experience role, you can use Standard or Data Center, and then typically you wouldn't install on the physical server with the Standard Edition, say, and run that physically. You would use the Standard Edition to create a Hyper-V host. That gives you two instances, virtual instances that you can then run. And in one of them, you could go ahead and turn on the Essentials Experience role. In fact, you could turn it on in both, but more typically you would turn it on in one. So we'll talk more about how that looks. But I wanted to start out, and I want to kind of use this architectural diagram here to kind of show how this builds and gives you these new options and kind of talk about it in terms of how it would actually look as you're installing it on a physical server, which I've kind of defined as this little dashed box. But typically, and in the past, and even still today, we see a lot of small businesses just install Essentials on a physical box, or again, this can come pre-installed from an OEM. And a lot of small businesses get started with their first server as a replacement for peer-to-peer network, or maybe they're using a PC as a server. Often they just are, you know, in a pure peer-to-peer with files just spread all over the place and nobody knows really where anything is, and backups are kind of happening ad hoc and different PCs get backed up and different PCs don't, and some information is protected and so on. And so this is really one of the primary values of introducing their first server and introducing Essentials into the environment, is to really improve the data protection that they have. So you can run applications on the server. So that's another thing that that it provides as a value for the business, is just a platform, a very stable central platform that can be used to run line of business applications. You can also use Essentials to work together with messaging and collaboration software or services that are available in the cloud as well as on-premises, as well as other cloud-based applications and services that can be integrated into the environment. So then if we have this physical deployment type thing, there is no Hyper-V parent partition, there's no Hyper-V or hypervisor. You just have the hardware layer, and then you have the Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials running on top of that hardware pretty much directly. And then you can use that together again with optional online applications and services and so forth. Now, when we look at what's new in terms of being able to virtualize with just the Essentials Edition, what we have now is a model that uses, again, that one single license, and the Hyper-V server role is now available as a choice with this Essentials Edition, where in the past, that server role just simply wasn't present. So you can install Hyper-V on the servers, on the physical server itself, so you basically create this parent partition that's running an instance of Windows Server Essentials, but that's only then used to run and manage the Hyper-V role. So there are no other workloads that run on the parent partition. You're not running Active Directory on that, you're not running line of business applications, you're not running a web server, you're not running anything else. It's just the parent partition to run and manage the Hyper-V role. So that in our diagram here, that's the green box, right? And then you can run one guest instance, and that guest instance can be Windows Server 2012 R2 Essentials. So that's in a child partition, or your guest VM, and so you have a VM now running your main workload, which is the Essentials Edition. And that is what is running in that child partition. That's where your Active Directory is, that's where your IIS is, that's where, you know, the remote web access runs on top of that web server, and you've got your line of business applications installed if you have any of those or want to do that. And all of that, the real workload runs then in the blue box in that child partition. And of course, this sits on top of the Hyper-V hypervisor, which sits on top of the hardware and gives you this ability to run multiple virtual machines. So doing this has a couple of advantages. And one of the main ones is the access to Hyper-V replica functionality. So this opens the door to a very low-cost business continuity solution that small businesses typically don't have. So it can be very expensive to do business continuity and develop a business or a disaster recovery plan that allows smaller businesses to fail over to a secondary site. But once you're running as a virtual machine and you have access to Hyper-V replica, that becomes a much easier path than to create solutions that do provide business continuity. So this is a main reason why to look at creating a virtualized environment even for the smallest of businesses. And again, this can be run together with optional online applications and services just like a physical deployment would. So as an example here, we have a great case study from a law office that took advantage of installing their business, their customer in a virtualized environment. And when Hurricane Sandy hit in the New York area, Hyper-V Replica really made this huge difference in being able to stay in business and allowing that primary workload then to fail over to a replica site that was not affected by the hurricane. And then employees were able to work from home and connect to that server that was running and continue to work and continue to function for their customers and stay up and stay in business. So the next thing I wanted to talk about is the Windows Server Essentials Experience role. So as you go into the typical Server Manager console and you choose to add roles and features and go through that very normal wizard, you'll simply see a new role in the list, and that is the Windows Server Essentials Experience. Now, when you purchase the edition, the Windows Server Essentials Edition, that role is turned on by default as part of the setup. When you purchase the Standard or Data Center editions, that role is not turned on by default, but it is available to you to go ahead and turn on. And when you do turn that on, then all the features and functionality are available to you as they are with the Essentials Edition. So it's a great way to provide these features and functionality in an environment that supports more than 25 users. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that when we cover licensing here in a bit. But basically, we've opened the door on a number of new scenarios and different ways that you can use the Essentials experience in smaller businesses, in medium-sized businesses, in branch offices, and so on and so forth, and provided a mechanism by which you can get this role installed. And you can do it in the typical ways that you would in a Windows Server Standard type of environment. You can use PowerShell to deploy the role and all these different things. So it works the same way as any other role that you have in Windows Server. So then looking more closely at installing this with a standard edition, and that really would help you scale again beyond the 25 user limit of the Essentials Edition. And again, looking at our architectural diagram, it looks exactly the same. We've got the parent partition that's being used to run and manage the Hyper-V role. Nothing else is running in that parent partition. And we have that, of course, sitting on top of the Hyper-V hypervisor layer, which sits on top of the hardware layer. But the license for Standard Edition gives you two virtual machines, two guest operating systems that you can run. So as an example, you can run one with the Windows Server Essentials role turned on, and that provides all of your basic infrastructure services, and then you have a second virtual machine that you can use to run other workloads. So again, this would be with just one license of Windows Server Standard. Data Center, of course, giving you as many virtual machines as you want. And you can choose then if you want to have the Essentials experience running or not. And again, this is just going to give a number of new scenarios and new possibilities, new flexibility that we just haven't had with being limited to just the Essentials Edition for these features and functionality. And as always, you can choose to run these together with optional online applications and services to provide an even richer experience. So taking just a quick look at a sample deployment scenario using the Standard Edition, you can create an environment that's much like a Windows Small Business Server environment, where you basically, the big difference is that you simply need to split off the Exchange Server role onto its own virtual machine. This is actually going to align much, much better with the best practices around running the Exchange Server, but let you do this with a single license. So again, you've got one license of Windows Server Standard giving you these two virtual machines that you can run. And then the first instance, we've got the Essentials experience turned on. So that's giving us remote web access, the client computer backup, email integration, whether you're running the Exchange Server on-prem works just as well. You've got the dashboard for doing all of your administration. And then in that second virtual machine, you can use that for these other workloads. And again, the example of Exchange Server running for on-prem email. And this is definitely a very viable deployment scenario, especially if you have, for example, like a line of business application that has deep integration with Exchange Server, and you want to maintain that. And that means you don't necessarily want to be running your messaging and collaboration in the cloud, but you want that running on premises in order to have that line of business integration if that's something that you need in your scenario. So this is just a way to visualize how you can have that experience all running on-prem and running with just a single license of Windows Server Standard. But we also, as I've been mentioning, have the Essentials experience available in the Data Center Edition as well. And you might be wondering, well, why why would a large business with Data Center really be interested in the Essentials experience? And really, the primary use case is probably for hosters. So hosters now have a very easy way to create a standardized image, standard on the Data Center Edition for all the virtual machines that they run for all their different customer types. But they can create an image that has the Windows Server Essentials experience role turned on, and that can be a great offering specifically for their small and mid-sized small and mid-sized business customers. So being able to take advantage of the features and functionality of Essentials, but run that at scale in a hosted environment for a number of different customers. And of course, each then virtual machine would be run isolated from all the others. They would run on their own virtual switch so that the network traffic is isolated, and then you're able to do that. So not only can third parties offer hosted solutions with this, but of course the Windows Server Essentials experience is available in the Windows Azure Gallery as well. So when you go into Azure and you're looking at creating a virtual machine, one of the choices in the gallery is to create an instance. And again, this is the standard Windows Server image, but it just has the Essentials experience role turned on. So this is a really, really great way to get started and looking at Essentials and how that works. You can get started in just a few minutes with a very small virtual machine that you can then easily adjust over time to scale as your needs grow. So you can extend that with, you know, multiple CPUs for the VM and more memory for the VM as that's needed. So you just pay for what you need, you pay as you go, and there aren't any upfront capital costs, of course, if you're running a virtual machine in the cloud. You don't have to buy a server, you don't have to buy hard drives, and so on and so forth. So it's basically a trade-off between, you know, not having capital expenses and then just that becoming ongoing expenses or operational expenses over time, which is very predictable and very steady state. So we see a number of customers interested in that kind of a model. And again, this is backed by all of the robustness of the Azure offering. So backed with service level agreements and you can choose what zone, what geographical zone you want to be running your virtual machine in, and there's the possibility of being able to run in a multi-zone type of environment if you choose to do that. So we have more installation guidance available. I have included a link to a site which has some more details around running the Essentials experience in Azure there as well. So a number of different options then that we have in terms of deployment scenarios. Again, from the traditional single server on-premise pre-installed from the OEM type thing that we've had for a long, long time, to being able to virtualize with just the Essentials Edition itself, to being able to virtualize in slightly larger environments with the Standard Edition and having multiple virtual machines that you run, all the way to running in the cloud. So just a tremendous number of different things that you can do. And then that introduces some interesting licensing questions, especially as you move from one to the other or start moving things around and really trying to understand how all of this works. So I wanted to kind of spend a few moments and cover some of the licensing basics. Now this, of course, does not tell you everything that's covered in the licensing terms that you get when you purchase the product, so but this is some basic training to make sure that you're familiar with how the pieces work. So the first thing that I wanted to talk about is simply the fact, and this hasn't changed for forever, that Windows Server licenses are assigned to physical servers, to an actual piece of hardware. And that's important to remember even as you start to virtualize workloads, because licenses are assigned to hardware, to physical servers. They are not assigned to virtual machines. When you assign a license to a piece of hardware, that defines how many virtual machines you can run on that piece of hardware. And in fact, you can assign multiple licenses to a single piece of hardware. We call this license stacking. And that can extend or expand the number of virtual machines that you could run on any one given piece of hardware. So as an example, if you buy two licenses of Windows Server Standard and assign them both to one server, then you can run four virtual machines on that server because you can have two virtual machines per license. So as you stack those together, you can run two and then four and then six and then eight, and then eventually it makes sense to look at the Data Center Edition so that you can run as many virtual machines as you want on a single server. So another thing that I wanted to mention is just the idea of license mobility. So licenses, volume licenses, can be reassigned. They can be moved from one server to another once every 90 days. And when you reassign it, it becomes, you know, not assigned to that original server and then assigned to a second server. So it literally moves. And you can't move OEM licenses, you can't reassign OEM licenses unless you've purchased software assurance. And then that opens up the same type of license mobility that volume licenses enjoy. But that's important to kind of understand, as it's different than when you use something like Hyper-V replica or Hyper-V's live migration to move a virtual machine from one server to another, from one Hyper-V host to another. Doing those things does not reassign the license that is assigned to the physical hardware. So you can totally replicate or migrate a virtual machine from one OEM server to another, because that has no effect, no impact on the license that's assigned to the hardware, to the actual OEM server. So that license cannot move from that OEM server, and it's okay. What's important is that the destination server that you're replicating to or you're migrating to, it must have sufficient licensing to run the instance that's being migrated to it. So let's go back to an example where you do have a server and you've assigned two Windows Server Standard licenses to that particular server, but you currently have three virtual machines running on it, and that's fine. So you're totally within license compliance, and in fact that server has the capacity to run one more virtual machine. So now you have another server and it's running a virtual machine. Let's just say it's an OEM server, and that's fine, it's running a virtual machine. And you want to migrate that a virtual machine running on that OEM server, you want to migrate it over to this other server that you have that has three out of its four virtual machines running. And you can absolutely do that, and that destination server has the licensing capacity to run that additional virtual machine, and it has no effect on that source OEM server at all. It still has its license assigned to it. So I'm kind of really kind of going over that again and again, but there seems to be quite a bit of confusion around how that works. And so at the end of the day, it's quite simple, that Windows Server licenses are assigned to physical servers. When you look at Windows Azure, it's nice to know that you really don't have to pay attention to that much at all, because the all the licensing is included in the subscription cost for the virtual machines that you have. So no real worries about how it all works there in the cloud. So then kind of related to that is client access licenses. And this is a little bit different. And again, there's some confusion here just around the Essentials Experience as a role in the Essentials Edition versus as a role in the Standard and Data Center Editions. So starting out, just talking about the Windows Server Essentials Edition. This server license provides the use rights for up to 25 user accounts and 50 devices to access that server. It does not have Windows Server CALs. Windows Server CALs are not included with the purchase of Windows Server Essentials. They're simply not used by that particular edition. It is the server license itself that provides use rights for up to 25 user accounts. So that's just very helpful to keep in mind, that the Windows Server CAL model does not apply to the Essentials edition of Windows Server 2012 R2, or to Windows Server 2012, the previous version, or to Windows Small Business Server 2011 Essentials, which was the version prior to that. The Essentials edition has never used the CAL model, and you don't get Windows Server CALs when you buy the Essentials edition. Similarly, you do not get RDS CALs when you buy the edition, and RDS CALs are not required when you're remotely connecting to client computers via remote web access. So the remote web access functionality that allows you to connect to remote computers uses RD Gateway, and that's important. When now we have the Windows Server Essentials Experience role that's available in the Standard and Data Center editions. So those editions do use the Windows Server CAL model, and you do need to purchase a CAL or a client access license for each user or device that's going to access those servers. So if you have the Essentials Experience running on a standard server, then if you're using RWA, which leverages the remote desktop gateway role of the remote desktop services, or RDS role, then you do need RDS CALs for those users. So we talk more about this in future modules. I talk about it quite a bit in our last module, which is the the user experience and how you can have the users connect remotely into an environment in different ways, where you can use RWA if you want to do that, if you can use also just VPN connections and use, you know, you can RDP directly to client computers in the environment if a remote computer is connected via VPN. So we'll talk more about that and the choices that you have and why you might want to do one versus the other and how that all works. But keep in mind that with the standard and data center editions, they do use the CAL model. You will need a Windows Server CAL for each user or device, and you will need RDS CALs for those users who are going to take advantage of any of the RDS features. And again, when you're running in Windows Azure, then the subscription pricing for your virtual machine includes CALs, so that you don't have to worry about that either. Next, I wanted to talk about upgrade and downgrade rights. And so upgrade rights is actually pretty simple. If you have software assurance, each edition of Windows Server 2012 upgrades to the same edition of Windows Server 2012 R2 at a 1-to-1 ratio. So no magic, nothing special. We actually kept it very simple in this go-round, which is wonderful because we don't always do that. But there are more questions that I hear around downgrade rights. So what can you do in terms of downgrade? So if you buy the 2012 R2 edition of Essentials, you can downgrade that to previous versions. So you can go back to Windows Server 2012 Essentials, and you can even go back to Windows SBS 2011 Essentials. And this is primarily done for application compatibility reasons. That's why we have downgrade rights, is to support these application requirements. So with SBS 2011, that was based on Windows Server 2008 R2. So if you have that need, that application need, you can exercise your downgrade rights then to go back to these previous versions. Now, the standard and data center editions can be downgraded to previous versions, and they can also be downgraded to lower editions. So you can downgrade data center down to standard edition. You can downgrade data center to standard, and then you can also downgrade both data center and standard to the Essentials edition. So if you downgrade to the Essentials edition, what does that mean in terms of your licensing terms? And that's the key question, especially based on what I was just talking about in terms of CAL requirements. The licensing terms of the product you purchased are what always apply. And this applies regardless of whether or not you choose to exercise your downgrade rights. You don't have to exercise your downgrade rights, but if you do, it does not change the licensing terms of the product you purchased. So if you purchased Windows Server Standard and then you downgrade an instance to running Windows Server Essentials and you install that as a virtual machine running on your Windows Server Standard server, as an example, that does not mean that you suddenly got the Windows Server Essentials licensing rights. You have Windows Server Standard licensing rights because that is the product that you purchased. So again, regardless of whether or not you choose to exercise your downgrade rights, the licensing terms of what you bought are what is in effect. So I hear a lot of questions about that. I just wanted to kind of include that. Now let's talk just a second about growing beyond the 25 user account. So this was fairly important in the Windows Server 2012 environment, when Windows Server 2012 did not include the role of Windows Server Experience, Essentials Experience, and you only had that in the Essentials Edition. So even if you were more than 25 users, you would need to buy the Essentials Edition and then buy the Standard Edition and then transition to so that you were not constrained by that 25 user limit. And so with the 2012 R2 Edition and the role, if you have more than 25 users to begin with, or are getting close to that limit and believe that you're going to grow, you don't have to purchase the Essentials Edition at all. You can purchase the Standard Edition right away and just turn on the Essentials Experience role and off you go. However, there is still the case when you may be a small business that fits comfortably within the 25 user limit, and that's fine. And then you should go ahead and purchase the edition and use that. And then later on, if you do grow, know that there is a very easy way to grow beyond the 25 user account limit. So you can do an in-place license transition. You don't have to reinstall anything. You basically just have to open up a command prompt with elevated privileges, enter in one single command that provides the licensing key the product key for your copy of Windows Server Standard that you would then buy. And you enter that in, hit return, reboot the server, and voila, you transition your license on your server to the standard edition. And you do this in place, no reinstall, no nothing. So that then is going to extend the capability, put you on the CAL model, and so you can have as many users as you want. When you're looking at that, however, in terms of using the Essentials Experience features, the maximum technical supportability limit is 100 users and 200 devices. And that's not to say that like the dashboard will just break and stop working at 100 users, but once you start to get beyond these limits, it's going to start making more sense to run the native tools to do your management. They are designed to work at scale, where the dashboard is really designed to help smaller businesses and provide a simplified experience. So then if you eventually get to a point where you don't need or want the Essentials Experience features at all, those then can also be removed entirely. And you can just use the server as if it was a Windows Server Standard Edition server without any of the Essentials Experience, and it can be very clean and straightforward, just like any other implementation of Windows Server Standard. So I have a link to a blog article there with more background and more information about this. It also links to a TechNet article that gives you the more technical steps on what to go through in order to make this transition. But just know that there is an easy path for growth beyond the Essentials Edition that will let you transition to Windows Server Standard without having to start over from scratch. The final thing that I wanted to talk about is just being able to use the Microsoft SPLA, or the Services Provider Licensing Agreement. So this is another option that folks have and that partners can look at as a way to offer the solution to their customers. There's a number of different areas that you can use with SPLA, whether it's for hosting virtual machines or databases or applications, so on and so forth. And there is a set of steps that you can follow in order to become an authorized SPLA hoster, and so those are outlined there. There's a link at the bottom of this slide that gives all of the details that you need, provides links to the documentations for the SPLA agreement, and that all that information is there. But I just wanted to make you aware that this was yet another option in terms of how you deploy and how you run Essentials or Windows Server in general. So the resources that we have for learning about SPLA take you through all of the phases, from planning to optimizing and building the environment to then selling it to customers. So again, I just want to include some information on the SPLA program and just make sure that you were aware of that. So that's quite a bit of information about the various deployment options that we have and some of the licensing implications and some of the licensing information that you should know about. I wanted to wrap things up with just some next step and some additional resources that you can use. We have a lot more technical information available in the Tech Center, and the Windows Server Essentials Tech Center, so I highly encourage you to check that out. We also have a very active blog. So this is contributed to from the development team, who writes articles about features and feature areas, as well as our customer and service support team, who blogs about issues that come up that you might need to be aware of, help you troubleshoot problems, or just proactively be aware of and adjust for things. We also do marketing posts where we talk about what's new and what's coming and things like that, announcements. So again, highly encourage you to check out the blog. RSS feed is a great way to go to stay current on what's happening. We also have a very active support forum, so if you do have any questions or thoughts, ideas, anything like this, please do join us there. That is, again, monitored not just by our development team, but also we have a very great community of MVPs who really help out and are active in our forums as well. And then finally, we have our product pages on Microsoft.com. So we have the Windows Server 2012 R2 product page, as well as the Essentials Edition has its own product page. And there you can download data sheets and white papers, and they provide links to the trial downloads so that you can get started and play with the bits and become more familiar. We also have a number of different partner resources for the partners watching. I wanted to make sure that you're available of our Ahead of the Game campaign and all the resources that are available there. So please do check that out. A lot of great information that you can leverage when talking to your SMB customers. We have a number of other partner resources. Again, I just wanted to make sure that you had these for reference as part of this deck. We also have some information here on how to buy Windows Server 2012 R2, what all the different editions are, and what they're good for in terms of the different scenarios that they support well, and the different comparisons of the features and the licensing models that they have. And then some additional links for pricing and licensing resources. Again, I just wanted to include this for reference. And then finally, some of our licensing programs that are most applicable for SMB customers. So again, just wanted to include this for your reference. So with that, thank you very much for joining me for this presentation today. I hope that that was valuable for you. And I also hope that you'll join us for additional sessions in this series.